All right, go right ahead.
Is my voice not delayed or anything?
No, your voice is good.
I would roleplay, but it would be a bit difficult with just one person, so I'll just use my voice.
I am ready, yes.
Okay. There was a certain man that had two sons. The younger said to his father, "Dad, I've thought about this, and I just feel there's nothing for me to do in this tiny town. I want to explore, live my life, independent. All of my friends, they've left home already, and I'm like a little baby just stuck here with mum and dad. And I think I can go out in the world and do something. I'll just need my savings that you've saved up, and I'll be able to make it." The father answered him, "Very well, son." And so the son went to the big city with all of his inheritance with him. "Yes, I'm finally free. I can eat and drink what I want. I can buy my own clothes and choose my own house. I don't have to share with anyone." A stranger approached him. "Hey, you must be new in the city. You know, you can make some money if you gamble, then you can party with us." "Oh, really? That sounds awesome. Yes, partying. That's something different. Let's go." And he spent all that he had. Wait, no, throw me out. The party's still going on. "We only party with the wealthy people. People that win when they gamble. Not like you. You've got no money left, so why don't you get lost?" So, the son had no money left. He had no place to go, he knew nobody. And he began to wander through the night in the big city, with no bed to lie on, no blanket to warm him, just the cold, wet cement. The next day, he went out of the city and found a farm on the way looking for a servant. He was hired to feed swine. "Hi, little piggy." "Ow! Don't bite me! So hungry, piggy. Can I have some of your snack?" "So hungry. I think I might just take a little bit." "Dad, all these years, you as your son. I have not sinned against you, yet you've never even given me a feast. But my brother, who spent everything on all kinds of debauchery, you give him a battered cup. His father replied, my son, you aren't ever with me. All I have is thine. It was meet that we should marry, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and now is found.
Okay, you did well. You had good voice inflections. That was good. And you say you do have it as a role play as well? Okay, all right, that's good. Very good. Thank you for doing that. Okay, we're going to move on today to some points about effectively communicating and the importance of public speaking, and give you some hints about that, and then you will be preparing a speech to give, and we'll talk more about that. So when we look at communication, this is what communication actually is. Communication is the process of sending and receiving messages. That's what communication is, the process of sending and receiving messages. All right? So I think you have a couple papers like this, one on effective communication and one on test to when choosing a topic. Let's look at the one on communication. All right? Communication involves six different variables, and you can fill in the blank. First of all, to have communication, we have to have a source. That is the originator. Do you have that paper?
Yep.
Okay, so the first number one is source. You have to have a source for the communication. That's the originator. And then you have the idea, which is the message. The idea. This is the message that's being communicated. The number three, you have the channel. How is it being communicated? All right, is it being communicated through a computer, through a person? How is it being communicated? Then you have a receiver. That's the destination. Who is receiving this communication? And then you have feedback. This is the response you get to the communication. And then you have noise. You have to always remember that noise is the interference that affects perception. Okay? Much of the success of a communicator depends on how they avoid, lessen, or deal with noise. So these are six important things: the originator, the message, the means, the destination, the response, and the dealing with noise. All right, then we have types of speeches that we can give. All right, there's several types of speeches that we can give. The first one is an informative speech. An informative speech. And this is simply giving information. Giving information. I'm going to inform you what my church looks like. So it's an informative speech. The next one is your testimony. Now, this testimony can be before conversion, when you were converted, or since you've been converted. Before, during, or after your conversion. This is a very powerful means of speaking, because a lot of times people will argue with your doctrine, they don't like your church, they don't like this, that, or the other about you, but they can't deny what you tell them has happened in your life. So your testimony is a very powerful means of communication. And then there is the persuasive speech. Nathan's sitting in here right now, and Nathan's getting ready to be involved in a persuasive means of communication through a debate. Okay? This is persuading the audience, giving them valid reasons for believing you. Okay? So, like in a debate, you don't even have to necessarily agree, but you have to be able to give valid reasons for your side of the, I don't like to use argument, your side of the debate, okay? But you may not always be in a debating situation, but you are trying to persuade your audience of something that you really believe in, usually. Like I said, in a debate, you don't always have to agree. Then there's a how-to speech, giving directions, how to get from my house to the nearest grocery store. And then lastly, there is what we call the impromptu speech. It would be as if right now I would say, Samantha, I would like you to give an explanation of Acts 2:38. Okay, it's impromptu. You've not had time to prepare. This is why I always say the more experiences you have in life, the more you read to expand your vocabulary, the better you can be if you're called on impromptu. Okay, I would dare say that working with Brother Nurse, you might sometimes be called on to do an impromptu speech. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's good that you're ready. It's good that you're prayed up. It's good that you are listening. It's good that you can recall experiences you've had. And it's good that you know the Bible. Okay, so when you're called on these situations, in the church that I grew up in, it would not be unusual for my dad to walk in for the class session time on Sunday at 9:30, and the minister would say, you're the preacher today in the main service. Okay, that wasn't uncommon. And that used to be how it is, not so much like that anymore. But you got to be ready. You got to be prayed up. You got to be, like I said, know the word, be able to recall experiences that you've had, all right, and be able to encourage people. All right, then on that page we have the parts of a speech. We have the introduction, a 3 to 5 point outline, and a conclusion. So your introduction is something that should be attention-grabbing, okay? You want to get their attention because they say you can lose an audience in the lose or keep an audience in the first couple minutes, okay? So it's important that you are able to do something to grab their attention. Maybe it's a visual. Maybe it's a costume. Maybe it's a slide on the PowerPoint. Maybe it's a big noise. It can be all kind of things to grab their attention. A lot of times people, like tomorrow, we're having a Super Sunday and we're having a bang countdown. Okay, it's going to grab their attention. So when you're speaking, you need something that will get their attention. Some people begin by telling a very moving story. Okay, that can grab people's attention. All right, so then after that, you want to have 3 to 5 main points of what you're trying to share. All right, whatever the topic may be, 3 to 5 main points. And then you're in your conclusion, you want to summarize those points and maybe reiterate what you said in your introduction, okay? Again, a story can be a good way to conclude, maybe getting feedback from the audience to make sure they understood what you were saying. Okay, there's been stories of little children going home from Sunday school and they weren't able to give the feedback that they were perceiving, and so they left with wrong perceptions. For example, there was the teacher who told the children about God driving Adam and Eve out of the garden. So this little one perceived in his mind a car with God in the front, Adam and Eve in the back being driven out of the garden. Okay? If the teacher had got some effective feedback, they would have known that wasn't quite the case, or that the child didn't understand. Or there was a song that was sung called Gladly the Cross-Eyed Bear. And the little child went home her thinking of a bear that had cross eyes. Okay? So, wrong perception. So it's very good in your conclusion maybe to get some feedback to make sure what you're trying to share has been understood. All right, any questions on any of that? Okay, then you have a paper that says a 6-point test when choosing a topic. Okay, let's look at this. If you're told to give a speech, what is it that you, how do you want to choose a topic? So the first thing is, do you happen to have your textbook there? The one Who Me Give a Speech, do you have that book? Or is it just on your computer?
It would be in my computer.
Okay, well let me just read you a little portion from that book. And by the way, you are to be reading this book, okay? So, okay. In this book, it has a good little quote on page 56. All right? So, and in this book, it gives these steps. Any organization is better than just speaking off the top of your head. You don't really want to do a lot of impromptu speaking. If you miss the mark, God may drop a few words in your mouth, but for the most part, you're going to have time to plan and prepare for a speech. So you need to take that time and plan and prepare. So the first thing you want to do, and it shares this in the book, is ask yourself this question. Does the information have universal appeal? Okay, is this something everyone that's in my audience would be interested in? In other words, if you're speaking to a whole group of women, you know, I know it's a modern age, but probably you wouldn't want to speak on car mechanics to a whole group of women, say elderly women, to even make it more so. Or if you have a whole group of elderly men, you probably are not going to speak to them on how to bake a cake. That's probably just not going to be of universal appeal to them. So you want to be very careful that you have something that has universal appeal. All right, the next question, number two, do I have victory in this area of my life? Okay, it doesn't mean you're perfect, but do I have victory in this area of my life? If I have trouble with watching too much television, and I'm going to preach on the evils of television, that's probably kind of going to be a little bit difficult for you. I knew a man one time, in fact, he was in the church, so to speak, and there was a new convert came in, and he blasted her about televisions, how awful televisions were. Then come to find out he had three in his house. You know, that doesn't make sense. So is it something you have victory in this area of your life? All right, also number three, does my life demonstrate what I'm trying to teach? Does my life demonstrate what I am trying to teach? So, you know, I don't need to tell you how important it is not to gossip, and yet I'm on the phone 24/7 or on the computer 24/7. Did you know? Did you know? Have you heard? Do you know? Okay, so does my life demonstrate what I'm trying to teach? Okay, will this topic insult or injure others? Will this topic insult or injure others? Okay, I could do a speech in our church, probably the same in your church, International Congregation, and I can do a speech on the great values of Brexit, eliminating all immigrants from our nation. Well, that's probably not a wise thing to do, okay? It's going to injure or insult others who may be immigrants. Okay, then I can say, will anyone be helped by my speech? Will anyone be helped? I could give an amazing speech, and it might even be interesting on Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. But what is it going to do to help anybody unless they're a serious music student? Okay? So ask yourself, will anyone be helped? And then lastly, can God be seen at work in what I am relating? Can God be seen at work in what I am relating? Now, as it says there, if all of these points aren't present, you don't have to throw it out. But this does let you know where your weaknesses are. You need at least 4 or 5 of these points to be present in your speech. All right? So keep that in mind when you're choosing a topic to speak on. All right, then we're going to talk about steps for developing a speech. All right, first of all, number one, you need to choose and narrow your topic. Don't just say, today I'm going to give a speech on the Bible. Well, are you going to do a book of the Bible? Are you going to do the Old Testament? Are you going to do the New Testament? Are you going to talk about how the Bible came into existence? Are you going to talk about the authors of the Bible? You know, you've got 10 minutes. What are you going to do? You need to narrow that down to a topic in the Bible, maybe a book in the Bible, at least the Old or New Testament, maybe a character in the Bible. So choose and narrow your topic. Don't make it too big. Today I'm going to give a speech on Britain. Well, what about it? You know, narrow it down to something that's doable in the time frame you have. Now, if you have 3 days, that might be another story. But if you have 10 minutes, you really got to narrow it down. And then you need to decide on a goal. What am I trying to accomplish through this speech? Am I trying to convince people that the Bible is true? Am I trying to give an example of a godly character in the Bible, or maybe an ungodly character? Am I trying to reach people with the salvation message? Am I trying to teach on healing? What is my goal in giving this speech? All right, and then as we've already said, choose 3 to 5 main points to focus on. I could have 1,000 points on the Bible, but I'm going to choose 3 to 5 main points to focus on that will get me to my goal. All right, then I'm going to organize the points. Organize the points. And then I'm going to develop the speech body specifics. Develop it. How can I best get these points across? Do I want to use some PowerPoint? Do I want to role play? Do I want to give a handout like I've given you? How do I want to develop these points so that the people really do get it? All right. Then number 6, write an introduction that gets attention, or plan an introduction, not write one. I tend to tell people don't write a speech out word for word because then you'll tend to read it, and most people can't read effectively. It just looks like they're reading and it gets monotonous. So plan an introduction that gets attention and plan a conclusion, reiterating what we've already said. There was a preacher who really, really got his point across one time. His goal in his message was trying to get people to realize that everyone needs the gospel and everyone should have the opportunity to receive it. So what the preacher did is he dressed like a down and out and sat outside the church, all messed up, looking very poor, looking very, very rough. Nobody recognized him. And all the people started coming into the church. Some of them were very upset that someone looking like that would be sitting outside of their church. And they tried to shoo him away, get him to leave, you know, tried to just ignore him or because he was an embarrassment. And then the preacher revealed who he was. And of course, they were all embarrassed for sure. But he got his point home very well because they found out that a lot of people didn't think the gospel was for everyone. Okay, so whatever you can do, an illustrated speech, an illustrated sermon always helps people to remember things better. Okay, so those are some points about speaking, or getting your topic. You have a paper there that says speaking tips. Speaking tips. Now this is good, and we're going to go through this. You got that one?
Yes.
Okay. Number one, you read it. Number one.
Speak so they can understand.
Okay.
Go on. Don't merely try to impress with your knowledge, vocabulary, and ingenuity.
Yeah, ingenuity. Okay, so I am going to speak to you today about the importance of having a wonderful vocabulary. I know that many of you would not even understand the language I'm using, but it is very important that I use proper vocabulary. Well, I've lost them right there because I'm condescending. All right, and I'm going to go into all these big words that I can't even think of right now, but I'm speaking above their level. So don't try to impress people that you're so knowledgeable or that you have this great vocabulary or you're so ingenious. Just speak on the people's level. That's what you want to do. Speak on their level. Don't speak down to them, but speak on their level. All right, don't assume that the audience is all at the same knowledge level. Don't say, of course you know the story about Noah. Well, you may have someone there who's never heard. Years ago, we had a Sunday school teacher here who was just shocked that the girl she was trying to teach had no idea whatsoever of the Easter story. They had no idea of it. So in the day we're living in, you know, it's not as common as you think for people to know the Bible stories. Watch Christian lingo. Okay, what do we mean by Christian lingo? Well, I tell people I don't say we should stop singing the songs, but you have to be careful that people understand some of the songs we sing. We sing songs about the blood. The blood will never lose its power. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. Power in the blood. Well, a little explanation for new people about songs like that would be helpful. Praise the Lord. Praise what? You know? Somebody asked me just the other day, what does hallelujah mean? Okay? So we can't assume that people know. Sometimes when we've been in Pentecost so long, we forget what it's like not to know all the lingo. So it's important. Okay? When I start a Bible study, and this is something we're going to do as well in the next few months, I don't go in and say, well, I'm sure you know the story about Daniel or David. They may not. You'd be surprised what church-going people don't even know, especially about the Old Testament. All right? So don't make them feel awkward by saying, of course you know, or I'll just skip over the story of Noah. I'm sure you know that. No, no, no. Just put them all at the same level. Now, if you are a humorous person, humor used wisely can be very effective. I'm not the funniest person. My husband is. He can use humor effectively. But if you use it effectively, it can be good. Number four, avoid crude words and too much slang. I'm going to say one that I don't like. I don't like this term, but I've heard it in the pulpit. I'm up here slinging snot. That's horrible. That's horrible. Okay? Or just slangy words. And because sometimes slang in one culture may be different than another culture. Okay? It's like here. You know, you don't say, you don't say that bloody coat. You just don't say that. Whereas in North America, you could say that. It wouldn't be offensive. Talking about Joseph's coat of many colors, the bloody coat. You don't say it like that here. Okay? So you have to be careful what cultures you're speaking to. All right, you read number five.
Do not tell inside jokes or stories that only a portion of the audience will understand.
Okay, I knew a pastor one time who had a lot of family in the church. And when he was speaking, he would tell family jokes that the rest of us didn't know. The family would all think, oh, ha, 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 ha. The rest of us didn't have a clue. And that's not a wise thing to do. All right, read number 6.
Avoid public pity parties for yourself. Always keep a balance between hope and despair.
I want to teach you today on hope, but my life is so miserable. I've had cancer, I've had 3 houses burned down, and I just got hit by a car. But I want to teach you about hope. Okay, well, you know, what I'm doing is I'm making you feel, oh my goodness, this poor woman, she needs help and hope for sure, you know. Don't give pity parties for yourself, okay? You want to be real. You don't want to look like some wonderful, holy person that has no problems. But you don't want to hang all your dirty laundry out, is a term I use, okay? So keep a balance between hope and despair. Number 7, when in doubt, leave it out. Should I say this or shouldn't I say this? Probably you shouldn't, okay? So when in doubt, leave it out. Maybe it may be something culturally wrong. Maybe I could be teaching on the horrors and the sin of rape. And I don't know it, but there's 6 people in the audience that have been raped. Okay? You know, I allow the Holy Ghost to trigger in my mind, okay? You know, maybe you better be careful about that. Not that it's not sin. You know, and not that it shouldn't be spoken against, but I need to be sensitive, okay? And if something niggles you to leave it out, then leave it out. All right, read number 8.
Avoid too many statistics and definitions.
Okay, they say one way to turn an audience right off the bat is to give a bunch of definitions, or when you're writing an article. The definition of hope is, well, they say that's a real turnoff. And a few statistics can be helpful, but if I give so many that the mind is boggled, they're going to forget them all anyway. One or two powerful statistics can be really good, like, say, 50% of men in Glasgow are alcoholics. Okay? I don't know if that's true or not. Okay, but if I said something like that, that's a powerful statistic. Half the men in Glasgow are alcoholics. But if I say, and there are this many alcoholics in Cambuslang, and this many percentage alcoholics in Parkhead, and this many percentage alcoholics in Maryhill, and this many percentage of alcoholics in Barrhead, they're going to get boggled. But just the 50% of men are alcoholics in Glasgow, they're going to remember that. Okay, so don't get too many statistics. Okay, this is one of my real pet peeves. Be sure you can pronounce any difficult names, places, or words. Don't get into the scripture and say the practice. If you got a scripture that's got difficult names or words like the Hivites, the Jebusites, the Girgashites, the Hittites, practice them beforehand. And some people who English is their second language, it's especially hard for them to pronounce some of those King James pronunciations. So practice the scripture beforehand. Don't practice on your audience. All right. Okay, you did this good in your story. Number 10, read it.
Voice inflections are very important. One tone voices are killers.
I want to tell you this story today, and I hope that you will like this story because it's a very good story, and I tell it in a very wonderful way, and it's very interesting to you, and I hope that you understand what I'm saying and the message that I am trying to get across to you in this story, and I hope that by now you have not fallen asleep. That will get old in about 5 minutes max, okay? But if I have a story that I want to tell you today, and it's really good, and I hope you'll enjoy it, and I really believe that this story is something that can bless your life, you can't fall asleep because, number 1, I'm loud, okay? But, you